My name is Collene Lawhorn, and I'm a neuroscientist by training, and currently I'm a program officer in the Division of AIDS Research at the National Institute of Mental Health. My primary role is to manage extramural research. My portfolio consists of two different areas. One area is around our long-standing work in neuroscience, and that's looking at the impact of HIV on the brain. The other area is a part of our behavioral and social sciences work, and that's looking at communication, dissemination, and engagement research, and where we tackle some of our questions related to misinformation. Misinformation is a major problem, but it's not a new problem. And what our research has shown is that no matter how much education you provide about HIV, or how much information you provide about how safe a new treatment is, or how effective an intervention is, that alone will not counter misinformation. And what we're finding is that there are deep roots in mistrust. So part of our work is to try to understand what some of the drivers of mistrust are. HIV-related stigmas and misinformation have improved, but they still persist. And while we're in a better place than we were 40 years ago when the first cases of HIV were reported, there still continues to be rampant misinformation driven by stigma around HIV. These kinds of stigmas driven by misinformation can greatly impact the mental well-being of people living with HIV, as well as those placed at risk for HIV, and have the potential to thwart HIV prevention and treatment efforts. So the COVID vaccine was developed in record time. And naturally, when you look at the timescales between the COVID vaccine and the future development of an HIV vaccine, which has been under development for decades, there are some questions. What people don't realize is that the COVID vaccine owes a lot of its success to related HIV efforts. There is one specific way we are trying to counter misinformation, and that's through a new program around health communication research to advance HIV prevention, treatment, and cure efforts. And we have several goals. The first is media campaigns and messaging that improve public understanding of HIV. The next would be addressing new communication technologies, which are providing incredible opportunities to address global disparities in HIV. Third, we want to use communication research to build trust in communities and to cultivate acceptance around HIV. Fortunately, in the U.S., almost no child dies from an HIV-related death. But what's unacceptable is that in countries in Africa, HIV and AIDS are still one of the leading causes of infant mortality. There are a few key things I try to keep in mind to help counter misinformation. The first two relate to how we approach research and the initiatives that we develop around that research. First, it's important when you're approaching your research to partner with communication specialists. So whether those are communication scientists that will help you with the research design, or communication professionals like journalists or marketing folks that will help you translate things at the other end. Second, it's important to harness data about misinformation in order to counter it. And the final one is more general advice about how to engage with the public. We need to refrain from rushing to judge members of the public who either believe or spread misinformation, but rather look at an individual's diverse life circumstances and the context from which they come. I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, and some of the earliest exposure I had to science education in elementary and middle school was not very good. So by the time I got to high school, I determined that science wasn't for me. So my path to a PhD in neuroscience was fairly circuitous. However, the thread of communication was always core to my work. And now I'm exactly where I want to be. I get to do great science around HIV, mental health, and the brain, and communication. I was a AAAS Science and Technology Policy Fellow from 2013 through 2015 at the United States Agency for International Development in the Global Health Bureau. I worked on the research team in the Office of Health, Infectious Disease, and Nutrition, where my primary role was to work on congressional research reporting, strategic planning, childhood injury, and clean cookstoves in sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia. My AAAS experience helped me tremendously. One of the pieces that I still reflect on is the idea of understanding the interface between public trust, communication, and policy. And what I learned was how to better generate concise, informative, and non-biased communications. AAAS is so important at a time when science information is being challenged. It brings together communities that rarely come together for important discussions to advance science in society. And for scientists like me, it provides an opportunity to reach our goals.